Circular economic model of growth offers India the roadmap for making ecological and economic welfare complement and sustain each other. The journey towards building a circular economic model needs a multifold approach requiring the engaged participation of government, industry, and citizens. Listen to this chat with Ms. Urvashi Prasad, a public policy specialist at Niti Aayog. Her work focuses on policy matters pertaining to the social sector.
Good evening, everyone. I am Susanna Lal, and on behalf of ICCE, I would like to welcome you all to Circular Chat, a talk series that takes place every Wednesday at 5 p.m. Our talk show involves an insightful conversation with people belonging to various sectors and agencies committed to work for a circular economy. We invite people from industries, governments, multilateral organizations, and nonprofits from a particular sector to understand all perspectives. International Council for Circular Economy, ICCE, was incorporated in July 2020 and formally launched in August 2020 to function as the first international body in India working on the principles of circular economy. ICCE is a global platform for public and private sector companies, civil society organizations, academic institutions, and business associations. We help align stakeholders' practices towards a circular economy's basic tenets in material efficiency, system design, resource recovery, and reducing negative externalities across sectors. ICCE operates on three strong pillars: educate, innovate, and inspire. Today, in another session of Circular Chat, we will have a discussion with Ms. Urvashi Prasad, a public policy specialist in the office of the Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog. Her work focuses on policy matters pertaining to the social sectors in the Vice Chairman's office. She is currently part of the core team supporting the work of Government of India's Empowered Group 1 for managing the COVID-19 pandemic in the country. Urvashi is a member of the task force for overseeing the implementation of sustainable development goals in India and co-authored India's first voluntary national review presented at the United Nations High-Level Political Forum on Sustainable Development in 2017. So far, Urvashi has over 100 publications in leading national and international newspapers, journals, and digital platforms to her credit. She's a member of the World Economic Forum's Expert Network and an alumnus of the World Economic Forum's Global Shapers Community. She completed her bachelor's from University of Birmingham, UK, followed by an MPhil from University of Cambridge and an MSc from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. Urvashi, we're very pleased to have you with us today.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here.
Yes. So, Urvashi, you are part of the core team, which is supporting the work of Government of India's Empowered Group 1 for managing the COVID-19 pandemic in the country. And researchers from UK's University of Warwick state that one of the most comprehensive solutions to support COVID-19 response and to build resilience is practicing circularity. In your opinion, what is the importance of a circular economy post COVID-19?
Yeah, so I think even before COVID-19, we were all realizing or starting to realize the importance of a circular economy, which very simply put is obviously trying to make use of our resources in as sustainable a manner as possible, generate as less waste as we can in whichever sector we might look at it, and then make use of whatever waste we do generate, see what value and wealth we can generate from that. So really, I think it applies to all our sectors, be it health, nutrition, and I know we're going to talk about some of these in more detail today, agriculture, environment. So I think, we were starting to realize this, be it policymakers, be it civil society, be it the private sector, because that is one thing which is very clear about the circular economy, that, government alone cannot make it happen. Of course, government has a very big role to play, and it has an enabling role to play. But government also requires the partnership and the support of the private sector in this, of civil society, of citizens. Citizens have a very big role to play as well in understanding why the circular economy is important and why it is beneficial for everybody. So I think that value will hopefully only increase in the post-COVID scenario, because we will need to, you know, one of the reasons why pandemics happen is because we've somehow disrupted the balance with the environment. That is a big reason why a pandemic happens to begin with. And keeping that balance in place, making sure that if we are using any resource, any natural resource, it is in a sustainable manner. It's when that balance sort of tips or things go off balance, that is when these kind of very catastrophic, either natural disasters or calamities of different kinds or pandemics, ultimately that is at the heart of it. So hopefully after the pandemic, this understanding which had started to build, even in the pre-pandemic era, it's still a relatively new concept for many of us, I would say, and in India as well, in many sectors, for many stakeholders, it's still a relatively new concept. But I think after a big event like this, a black swan event like this, people will hopefully value it even more, that, you know, we need to have this balance between, you know, our resources, how we live, we need to make it sustainable. And ultimately, that will be beneficial for all of us. So I think that is what I hope will happen in this post-pandemic era, as far as understanding the and appreciating the importance of a circular economy is concerned.
Right. We hope the same, Urvashi. Also, Urvashi, we know that you have extensive experience in health and nutrition as well. So how and to what extent could a circular economy of food contribute to improving diet and nutrition-related health outcomes?
Yeah, so food, you know, if we start by looking at agriculture itself, you know, in agriculture, a lot of the practices that we adopt are not very sustainable. For instance, when we grow only a particular type of crop, if we grow only rice, which consumes a lot of water, then we really make those regions water scarce. If we don't practice dietary diversification, crop diversification, so, you know, instead of just growing rice, if we can also grow crops like millets, which don't consume as much water, then it would be much more sustainable from an environmental point of view, because we are already running into huge water shortages in many, many parts of the country and indeed the world. This is not just an Indian problem. This is true world over. So something like that, which is beneficial for the environment, is also actually beneficial for people and for health, for population health. Because if you have more dietary diversification, if you are having a mix of cereals, for instance, if you are having more of millets, if you are having more of certain pulses, you are likely to be having a more balanced and nutritious diet as well, as opposed to if you are having a diet which is only rich in, you know, or dependent on the staples of rice and wheat. Of course, they are important. They have their role to play. But you need many more nutrients beyond that. So in fact, if we look at, you know, what we're trying to even do in the nutrition space, even as the government, we are really trying to promote this sort of dietary diversification, because it has twofold benefits. One, as I said, is for agricultural practices to be more sustainable, for us to conserve water. And for the other is the population health. You know, it's actually more beneficial for people's health to have a more diverse and a more balanced and ultimately a more nutritious diet. Similarly, if we look at, you know, consumption of the non-vegetarian food, if we look at animal you know, products. Again, now that is where we really increase the carbon emissions when we are actually manufacturing a lot of the meat-related products. And, you know, the industry is a great contributor to the carbon emissions, the overall sort of, and now we are facing a lot of global warming. We are facing a whole host of environmental climate-related challenges. Equally, we also know that diets rich in animal fat are actually not good for health as well. And we are now seeing an incidence of non-communicable diseases in India rising. In fact, non-communicable diseases now account for about 65% of the disease burden in India. So there's a massive shift. You know, we started with a country that was mostly grappling with communicable diseases, maternal, you know, child health issues. Now we are moving more and more towards the NCDs, you know, so your lifestyle related diseases, diabetes, cancer, hypertension, and a lot of this, it's not just, you know, consuming animal products, but a lot of it is contributed through this as well, through a diet which is rich, disproportionately rich in some of these products. So again, we see here that there are, the benefits are twofold. You know, one is that you are doing good to the environment. If you're actually reducing your sort of meat consumption, you're reducing the sort of overall carbon emission that is going out. On the other side, you're actually doing your own health a great deal of good. So I think that is what we have to see in the food and nutrition space, that it is a win-win for many stakeholders. It's a win-win for those in the agriculture sector. It's a win-win for people who work in the water sector. And you know, water is such a big challenge for us now. I mean, a lot of people say that the next world war could be fought over water because we are so short of water. So these are big issues. These are issues that don't just concern the government. It concerns everybody. It concerns the private sector. It concerns any citizen. As any citizen, you might feel that this is not going to impact me, but ultimately the impact will be on all of us. So I think that is how we need to look at it in this. We have to look at the whole end-to-end sort of chain, you know, starting right from the agriculture, going right through our production practices, manufacturing practices. What are the harmful effects at every stage of what we're doing? And ultimately ending up with the consumer. Or the individual who is actually, you know, consuming those products in terms of what's the impact on their health and their well-being. So I think that is how we really need to look at it in this context of food and nutrition. And I think, as I said, the government has already started to take some steps here to try and make both the agriculture side of things more sustainable and also to improve population health. But there's a lot more that we need to do in terms of citizen awareness and engagement as well, because, you know, people need to be conscious. And the other element that actually is important in this is the local, you know, so growing foods more locally, you know, shifting sort of growing of food closer to people. That is also something that we are looking at here, because that is also much more sustainable. It also fits in more with the local patterns of how people consume food, what are their preferences. It makes best use of, you know, whatever are the best nutrient combinations that people can have in different regions of the country. So I think also making that move, you know, away from necessarily just the very large scale industrialized to closer to people, more localized as well. So we need a balance. Of course, we need the other end as well. But the whole point about this, you know, the circular economy and all of this is the balance and trying to bring in that fine balance, which makes it sustainable for every stakeholder across the value chain.
Right. That's very right, Urvashi. And I'm sure the audience will try to absorb your words. Coming to policies, Urvashi, what are the new policies being formulated to support businesses to adopt a long-term circular market model? And are there any challenges being faced in the implementation process?
Yeah, so as I said, the policies are you know, very are different depending on the sector we are looking at. You know, so if we're looking at health or we're looking at nutrition, agriculture, the entire waste management space, which of course has a very big role to play when we're talking about circular economy, and in the context of cities, because India now is increasingly becoming urban. We are urbanizing at a very rapid pace. The government has of course announced initiatives like smart cities, etc. But you cannot have smart cities if you're still generating this sort of large amounts of solid liquid waste, which is then not being sort of used in any proper manner. And so that waste to wealth concept that we're talking about is something which the government is cognizant of, but we still need to operationalize it. Because in India, you know, a lot of these things are down to the level of states and city governments. It's not just the central government, you know, sitting here, which can do all of this. But we're certainly trying to enable a lot of these things. In fact, even, you know, if I give the example of Swachh Bharat, for instance, we started Swachh Bharat very much focused on, you know, expanding access to sanitation, to individual household toilets, etc. Now the Swachh Bharat Mission 2.0 actually is all about, you know, waste management and proper waste management, proper liquid, solid waste management, checking air pollution in our cities. In fact, even in the budget this year, you know, some of you might have noted there were a lot of announcements around, you know, air pollution, around drinking water, around the sludge management, you know, solid liquid waste management in general. So I think all of that is a move towards more sustainability, towards more harmony and balance with our environment, with our resources, and ultimately also, you know, benefiting every stakeholder, as I said. You know, that is something that is at the heart of what the government is trying to do in its policies. Now, of course, as I said, there are sectoral, you know, specific efforts that are happening, but in general, the government is looking at things like tax incentives for industries, for instance, to actually cut down their you know, emissions, cut down their waste, ensure that the waste is used, you know, or disposed of in a sort of sustainable manner. So there's a lot of different kinds of tax incentives and other measures that the government has been considering for various sectors, because this will have to be a sector specific approach. The government cannot come out with just one overarching policy, because it won't work. We'll have to look at the circular economy in the context of every different sector, some of which I, you know, elucidated here, and then see what are the kind of incentives that can actually be given. But ultimately, as I said, that, you know, one is the government incentive and the policy push. But the other is the private sector themselves seeing the value of some of these things. And I think that is going to be very important as well.
Right, Arvashi. And considering all the experience that you have, we would love to know your views on the collaboration of the private and public stakeholders to attain a successful transition from a linear to a circular economy.
Yeah, just give me a second. Sorry, I have a bad throat.
That's no issue.
Yeah, so your question is around the public-private partnerships, right?
Right.
Yeah, so I think, you know, as I think we've been sort of touching upon that across, you know, this discussion that we've had, that it will very much need to be every stakeholder understanding the intrinsic value of the circular economy as well. Because, you know, there's only so much incentive or push that can be given. And of course, that should be given. Because as I said, the government has a much larger role to play. But also the private sector on its own needs to understand that a circular economy is ultimately more beneficial and sustainable for everybody and makes good economic sense. Because I think that's the lens that they are coming at. They might not be so concerned with the general societal good necessarily, or the general sort of environmental benefit, or the climate change related benefits, because a lot of these are public goods. So the private sector might not be directly so concerned with these things. But definitely it makes economic sense in the end. Because as I said, you know, if we are not using resources sustainably, ultimately they will run out for all of us. Even if I'm trying to set up an industry in an area and, you know, the water has, you know, is running short, or there is some sort of other environmental issue there, ultimately I will also suffer, my business will suffer. And so it will not make economic sense for me to live in that sort of disruption. Now that we've had this pandemic, the whole economy has suffered. You know, it's not just the government which has suffered, it's not just people, the entire economy has suffered. So many companies have had to shut down. So it just goes to show that one such event, you know, at the end of the day, it's just one such event. It's shut down economies, businesses across the world have suffered. So I think that understanding will be very crucial when we're talking of the public-private sort of collaboration, because in a lot of times we just talk about the government pushing certain policies or incentivizing, which of course needs to be there. But that alone cannot make it happen. You know, there also needs to be that pull factor from the other side to say that, okay, we too realize the value of having this sort of circular system. So I think, and you know, it'll also create additional opportunities for the private sector. So as I said, suppose people are moving more towards nutritious foods, or people are becoming more conscious, that actually creates a whole host of new opportunities. It creates a new segment that might not have been explored before. So I could have a whole line of products based on millets, for instance, right, which are so much healthier. I could have a tasty snacks which are based on millets. So it's not to say that, you know, it doesn't have economic opportunities, it doesn't have business opportunities, and that's why it's called circular economy, because ultimately, you know, it makes economic sense, but it also has major positive externalities. So it also makes environmental sense, it also makes societal sense, and therefore it's a much grander and broader concept. So I think that it will be at the heart of it. And as I said, in India, we are still at a relatively nascent stage, relatively in certain sectors. You know, we still don't have that advanced an understanding of why this is important, what this is, what this really means for us in, you know, our day-to-day life, etc. But I think we will reach that level gradually. As I said, the understanding is starting to build up. And just over the last few years, I've seen it build up in a big way in the different sectors I work in. So I think it will happen, but yes, it's a natural, you know, over the course of time. And it's important to, in our discourse, make every stakeholder see the value that they can derive out of it. Because ultimately we act, you know, when in a way when we can see what value we can get. So I think that is really going to be at the heart of this.
Right, absolutely, Urvashi. Also, bringing your thoughts on the sanitary napkins and its disposal now. So we know that incinerators have been installed by many companies in schools, hospitals, etc. And the disposal is an issue, and also the environmental impact of incinerators. So according to you, how grave is this issue and how should it be tackled by the government?
Yes, so as I started talking about the Swachh Bharat and its natural progression, one other element of its natural progression will be looking at the whole menstrual hygiene management space and going beyond, just access. You know, I mean, I think it's important to understand in India that we are often going step by step because we have so many challenges and we have a huge space to conquer. So in sanitation, we had to first start with access, because people didn't even have access to a toilet. And even now, there are plenty of people who might not have access to a functional toilet or a usable toilet. Now, the same is true for menstrual hygiene management. There are so many girls and women, menstruators, who don't have access to even basic sanitary products. So the very first focus of the government has naturally been on that, you know, how do we first expand access? Now that we are starting to ramp up access, and in fact, the National Family Health Survey 5 data from the few states, which has come out recently, the US, we're still awaiting data from all the states, but from the first set of states, the data is quite encouraging that, you know, adoption of sanitary napkins and sanitary products has gone up even in some of our poorer states, you know, even in states like Bihar, West Bengal, etc., which is very encouraging because that's the direction we want to take. But there's the flip side to it, you know, as access to these increases, we are then facing the issue of their disposal, and we are facing the issue of their safe disposal. And then what do we do with the sanitary napkins? You know, how do we dispose them? What do we do with the waste? So that is the end now that we have to tackle. And that is the end that the government is now naturally sort of progressing to. Once we start addressing the access issue more and more, we now move on to the whole waste management part. Now, here also, I think it's very important that, yes, we need incinerators, we need infrastructure, you know, of that kind. We need the hard infrastructure. But also the behavior is very important. We need to educate people about the type of sanitary products they are using and the sort of environmental consequences, impact. As I said, these are much harder to do things, because I, as an individual, might not care so much about it. You know, for me, it's just a sanitary product. I use it and that's it. I might not care so much about the broader consequences, but we do need to educate people about these things. Like, you know, you try and use products which can be more sustainable. Of course, we need to increase access to those sustainable products as well, because bulk of India, still, you know, women in most of India would still not have access, easy access to those products. They need to be affordable as well. You know, affordability is a very big question mark in India. You can have the best of product, but if it's not affordable, then again, that's a big challenge for us. So we are dealing in a very complex space here where we have many factors to consider. You know, if you are a richer country, it's almost a little easier to say, okay, I'm just going to look at the environmental impact. I'm just going to, you know, I don't have to bother about cost. I don't have to bother about access, but we have to bother about all these different dimensions. So I think the government is also focusing on trying to come up with more sustainable products, which are environmentally friendly, but which are also affordable, because that's a very big sort of challenge, and that's something that the government has to look into. And so I think this also creates a lot of scope for private sector innovation, because if the private sector at scale, you know, can come up with these products, which are sort of, you know, whether it's biodegradable or whichever way it is more environmentally friendly, then I think that could be a huge opportunity, because, you know, as I said, access is going up. More and more women are now using these products. The demand for these products is going up as we start to address the social stigma related issues. So it's a big opportunity as well. It's an opportunity where, you know, a lot of innovation can happen. And we can use technology also in a big way to sort of manufacture these products in a sustainable manner at scale and while driving down the costs. So I think all these different dimensions is what we need to look at. And the government is certainly trying to focus. As I said, we are moving gradually towards that end of the spectrum now. We are shifting our attention beyond just access. Access remains a challenge, but we're shifting also beyond that now. To look at these aspects. But in doing so, it's not just the hardware, as I said, it's not just the, you know, the incinerator or just installing a machine. It's much beyond that. It's also the behavior, it is also the sensitization and the innovation that needs to come about in this space.